Last week we were in Sardis, and what we said about Sardis, there wasn't a real particular critique other than that they were just dead. He said, you're dead. You have a name for being alive, a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. And we equated that to being, to not being alive in Christ. We know those, or you've heard of, or perhaps at some point in time in your life where you just came to church, you were just going through the emotions. You just said, yeah, I understand that. And I agree with that. I agree with Christianity, and we call ourselves Christians, but we have not yet accepted him in the heart. It has to be in the heart. It's not a matter of affiliation, coming to church, or growing up, and my mom and my dad, they were Christian, so that makes me Christian, or, you know, I was baptized at some point in time. I have my confirmation certificate. No, it's a choice. We each have to allow him into the heart. You can't have that relationship with him on the outside. You have to let him in. You can't talk through him to the door and say that I'm alive in Christ. You have to let him in the heart. You have to let him in the heart. He says that I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone would hear my voice, I will come in and dine with them and them with me. Amen. We have to let him in the heart. This is what it means to be alive in Christ. And so today we're looking at Philadelphia, and this church is doing a pretty good job. It's one of the two churches that haven't received a critique. They're doing well. I see this as Christ. He's wanting to affirm them. He's wanting to assure them of their works, their deeds, to encourage them to remain fast, to stand fast in the faith. Amen. So just a little bit about Philadelphia. This city, as we know, it means brotherly love. We have a city called Philadelphia. It was named after these two brothers, Eumenes and Achilles. They were believed to have founded this city, and they had a great love for one another. And so it's believed that they named it. One of them named it. This region, this area, it was prone to a lot of volcanic activity, a lot of earthquakes. And so a lot of the citizens, they lived out in the rural areas. They would, when they would be in these condensed, densely populated areas, when an earthquake or a volcano erupted, they would have to flee out into the outer region. So many of them just stayed out there because it wasn't safe to live in the city. And so they took up a lot of them took up agriculture. Vineyards was very popular because of all the volcanic ash. It made it very fertile ground. And so you'll see in this letter, I think that has a bit to say about what Jesus is affirming to them, that them having to constantly go out and seek refuge because of the threat, this threat of earthquakes and volcanic activity. And so, like I said, I see this letter as Christ wanting to comfort them and assure them. He knows their situation. He knows what they're going through. They're dealing with all kinds of natural adversity, and they're also dealing with adversity from those that should be their brothers, those that should actually love them. And we'll see that. They're dealing with all kinds of adversity, and Christ is wanting to assure them. He's wanting to comfort them. Amen. So in verse 7, it reads, to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. So this word holy, we can understand it. Well, first, let me say that as always, in all of these letters, Jesus, he he describes himself to the church in different ways. And what we've said is that the way he describes himself, it speaks to the situations that they're facing. And he's wanting them to understand who he is. In light of what you're going through, you need to understand who I am in the midst of what you are going through. And we all need to know that. Who we serve, the situations that we face, there is nothing on earth that we cannot go to God with. He is our all. And so he's telling them that he is holy. This word holy, it can be understood in two basic ways. It speaks to being set apart for the will of God. Things that are set apart for God's service, it is holy. And God is holy. It is divine attribute of God. God is holy. He alone is holy in that sense. And so we understand that we are holy and that he has made us holy. It's not our holiness. He has imputed his holiness to us, and we are set aside for his purposes. But he alone is holy. Holiness originates with him. Does that make sense? And so he's saying that I am holy. I am the one that is holy. I am the one that is true. This is Jesus speaking. And so that tells you a lot, that there is no falsity in me. There is no wrong in me. I am true. I am holy. I am God. He's telling them. He's wanting them to know who he is. He's speaking to his authority, to his power. I am holy. I am true. He says, I hold the key of David. I hold the key of David. This is an allusion to Isaiah 22, pretty much that whole chapter. And I want to explain why we go to other passages. This word of God, it is God breathed, all of it in its entirety. If you want to understand scripture, you interpret it through scripture. If you think of a ball of yarn, you know, it's all the, you pull a piece out and you keep pulling pieces. You have what seems to be all of these different pieces of string, but you unravel that string, it's all one string. And this is the word of God in its entirety. And so we want to understand scripture. We look to scripture to interpret that. And so this is an allusion to Isaiah 22. And what God is speaking to the rulers in Jerusalem. And they haven't been doing what they've supposed to have been doing. And he's saying, I'm going to kick you out of here. I'm going to throw you out. I'm going to cast you out. I'm going to remove you from your positions because you are not doing what I've commanded you to do. And he says, he speaks of his servant, Eliakim. He says, in that day, I will summon my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and fasten your sash around him and hand your authority over to him. He will be a father to those who live in Jerusalem and to the people of Judah. I will place on his shoulder the key to the house of David. Do you see that? You see what he's saying here? He's saying, I hold the key to the house of David. And here we see in Isaiah, he's saying, I will place on the shoulder. To have something placed on one's shoulder, it's figurative way of saying that authority has been handed over to that person. They have the authority to act in the will and purpose of God. And here Christ is saying, he's saying, look back. And this is a Jewish audience. It's a mixed church, perhaps, but they would have understood this. They would memorize Isaiah from childhood. And so immediately they would make this connection. Wait a minute. Yahweh said that he will place the key. And here you're saying that you have it in your hand. He's saying, I am God. I have the authority. I have the power to give authority. I have the power to do that. I have the authority to do that. I hold the keys And so, like I said, I see this as Christ assuring, giving assurance, encouragement to this church. He's explaining that he has authority, that he is true. He is the one true God. He's wanting them to know that their efforts are not in vain. I understand that you're going through some things. The world around you seems to be crumbling, and those that should be your brothers and sisters, they're coming against you. But just understand, I have authority. I have the power. I can flip things at a flip of a switch. I can turn this world upside down, and I will. I'll flip the script, he's saying. I have the authority. In verse 8, it reads, I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Again, he has authority. I have authority. I have power. I can open a door that no one can shut. I'll make a way that no one can stand in that way. I know you have little strength, he says. This word, dunamis, it means power. We translate it as power. It means like authority, or not necessarily authority, but ability. One that has the ability to render an effect. You're able, you're capable. I don't see him speaking necessarily to the physical strength of this church, but perhaps their ability, what they're able to do. They don't have much ability. They're trying, but they're not able to do much. At least to them, it seems they can't do much. And I know this just, it should hit the nail right on the head, because often we feel powerless, we feel unable, that we don't have much dunamis in this walk. You know, we all have family members, neighbors, loved ones, perhaps your own children that you've raised up in the faith. You've done your very best to teach them the way that they should go, to bring them up in the word of God, and yet they've gone astray. Yet they don't want to hear it. And you've shared the gospel inside and out, and you've prayed and you've prayed and you've prayed, and it just seems that there's nothing much you can do. They're just further away from God than when they first began. And we feel a bit hopeless. We feel helpless. You don't feel like you have much power, much dynamis. And this has been one of my biggest struggles in ministry, is feeling just not having much dunamis. You know, day after day, seeing how many children get high. Just I watch them get high. And countless times I've gone out and tried to talk to them, and nothing seems like it does no good. You see, you encounter all the homelessness, and you talk to them, and you want to share the gospel with them. And you try to get them to see that there is hope in Jesus Christ, that God, he has the power, he has the authority to flip the script. He can turn your life upside down, inside out. And you just feel hopeless, because you know this power, you know the power of God, how effective it is. I know we've seen it in our own lives. I know I have, should have been dead long ago. But just knowing the power of God and what he can do if you just let him in the heart. Just let him in. And you plead, and you just pour out and pour out, but yet it just seems like there's nothing. It just falls upon deaf ears. You feel like you don't have much ability to do much of anything. You can't make a difference. You want to share this word so that they can have hope and be free from addiction and whatever else they're dealing with. But it just seems to fall on deaf ears. And it just seems that nowadays, society is just moving further and further away from any notion, even of there being a God, let alone accepting Jesus Christ, but refusing to accept that there's even a higher power, that It's just this growing sentiment that humanity itself is God, that humanity itself has the ability to reason and to determine what is right and what is wrong and decide for itself its own destiny. It wants to maintain all the authority for itself, all the power for itself. I know you all have heard by now this term called cancel culture. You've heard of that? And if you haven't, what that is when you say something or you do something that goes against mainstream society, they sort of cancel you out. You're ostracized. You're cut off as if you were never even born. The world around you, they want nothing to do with you. They will not acknowledge your existence. And it's become more and more prevalent that those that stand on the word of God are being canceled out. This ministry, in a way, we've been canceled out right here in this city. It didn't come as a surprise to me, but it was a bit surreal that we would be singled out to be canceled. We were canceled. Along with about five other churches. We were told that, you would participate in this event, but we don't want you all involved with that anymore because of our position on the inerrancy of the Word of God, the infallibility of the Word of God. And to that I say amen. Amen. I'm not concerned with being canceled. I'm not concerned with what society says. We're going to stand on this word. Amen. But we serve a God that has the ability, that has the authority to flip the script. He can turn things upside down. He can turn at a moment's notice. If you think of Joseph sold into slavery by his own brothers, falsely accused by his master and thrown into prison. And then just one day he's exalted. God was with him and God said he pulled him out of that prison and exalted him to the right hand of Pharaoh, made him the second most powerful person in all of the land and the most powerful empire during that time. God has the ability to do that. To take one from the very depths of the dirt and exalt him up on high. God has that power. That is the God that we serve. And he's telling this church, know who I am. Understand who's talking to you. Don't lose sight of that. Your efforts are not in vain. Be encouraged, he says. He says, I will make those who are the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars. I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. And so he says the same thing to the church in Smyrna. And we don't really have very little understanding of or writings about what happened in this church, but we do have with Smyrna. And so we can only assume that there's a similar situation going on here. And we know that in Smyrna, the Jews were persecuting the church. They didn't want to be affiliated with the church. We talked about the bishop in Smyrna, Polycarp. It was the Jews that sought him out, the Jews that brought these charges to the Romans against him. It was the Jews that found him. It was the Jews that when he was condemned to be burned at the stake, it was the Jews that went and gathered the wood and brought it for him to be burned alive. And so we can only speculate that there's a similar situation going on here with the Jews who are their brothers. Their brothers and sisters in Christ are standing against them, are opposing them, are coming against them. And let me be clear, this is not an anti-Semitic statement, as many would try and interpret. He's not speaking to the entire Jewish nation. He's talking to these, speaking to these, their actions. What they're doing, He says they claim to be a synagogue. They're Jews, but they're a synagogue of Satan. They're liars. And here he says that I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Understand, I have the keys to the house of David. As he spoke to Jerusalem in Isaiah, he was saying that you haven't done what I've told you to do. I'm going to strip you of your authority. I'm going to strip you of your power, and I'm going to give it to my faithful servant. And we see here he's saying, I have that power, that authority to cause them to bow down at your feet. They will know that I've loved you. He says, since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. Now, depending on who you read, who you follow, what denomination you are, this is a big talking point. This is another one of those passages where we go our separate ways. We fight and we fuss and we just can't see eye to eye. Many will look at this and see this affirming a pre-tribulation rapture. Others will look at it and say, no, that's a post-tribulation rapture. And they're speaking about whether God is going to remove the church before the period of trial, or he's going to sustain them during the period of trial. And to that, you know, last week, I told you I felt real stupid having tried to figure out where I would position myself on whether one eternal or once saved, always saved, or whether you could turn from the faith. And I said it all didn't really make much sense. It all said the same thing in the end. And to that, I said the same thing here. I didn't feel like feeling that much more stupid and trying to figure out or put myself in someone's argument. The fact of the matter is that we know it to be true either way. We know that we've gone through some things. We've gone through some trials. And we know that God has sustained us in those trials. We've gone through tribulations. And if it was not but for him, we would have never made it. We know that there are some things that we should have went through, that he had the power and the authority to take us out of it, that we didn't have to go through it. So either we go through it or we rapture out of it beforehand. God is with you. That is the point that I want you to understand here, that whether you're going through a trial or whether he takes you from a trial, God is with you every step of the way. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. He is with you. So whether it's pre-trib or post-trib, it really doesn't matter, because Christ is with you. He is with you. Amen. He says, I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. Now, I said that given the geographical region that this church was in, it would give us some kind of indication in what Jesus is saying and what he's wanting them to understand. As I said, they would often have to flee the towns and go off into the rural areas because of all the volcanic activity and the earthquakes. And so it wasn't safe for them. And so imagine hearing this. I'll never have to go out again. I'll never have to flee again. He says, you will never go out. You'll never leave there. And so he's speaking specifically to them in their situation. Understand who I am. I know what you're going through. I see it. But just trust in me. Trust in me. You're never going to have to leave again. Just hold on to what you have. I'm going to make you a pillar in the temple of my God. And so what does that mean? To be made a pillar in God's temple. This is a bit peculiar, you know, reading this. I mean, it's considered in previous verses that it's an honor. They would name, I think there's two posts that were named after two individuals in the temple. And so it was an honor to be named, to be made a pillar in the temple. But fast forward a little bit at the end of this book, and chapter 21, After Satan has been vanquished, he's been thrown into the fire, all those followers, all is said and done, judgment day has passed. And John, he's describing what he sees. He's describing this Jerusalem, this new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. And he's looking at the foundation, he's looking at the walls, he's looking at everything, and it's just beautiful. He's describing it in all of its beauty, all of these precious stones of onyx and sapphire and gold, and it's just beautiful. And something strikes him. You know, he was a Jew. John was a Jew. He'd been to Jerusalem, and in Jerusalem, there's in the center of it is the temple. And so looking at this new city coming down, this new Jerusalem, he's like, wait a minute, there is no temple. And he says, because God and the Lamb are the temple. Do you see that? And so what does it mean to be made a pillar in a temple that is God? We don't know. We don't know. We can only speculate. I wouldn't be much of an exegete if I wouldn't have tried to give it a go. So I can tell you what I think, give you my own two cents, and you can take it or leave it, or have your own guess at it. Yours is almost as good as mine. I see this, you know, and I did a whole study on this, and I'll spare you that and just get right to the good stuff. Amen. What I see this saying is God is saying that you're never going to leave me. I'm never going to leave you. You are going to be a permanent fixture in me, and we're going to be together. No more running out. No more being afraid. You will be with me. You will see me. You will experience all of my glory. You will see me, you will experience my love like never before. This is where we're going. He's encouraging them to hold on. We're going to be together. We are one. We are one. This brought me to John. As I was thinking of John, it really just, the Gospel of John, it really just kind of resonated this passage in chapter 17, verses 22. Jesus, he's praying to the Father for our benefit. He says, I've given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. This, I see this speaking to God's love that we are going to experience in him when we encounter, when we meet with him, when all is said and done. No more fleeing, no more tears, no more crying, no more pain, no more suffering. We will be made one in God, and we will worship together in him for all eternity. No more leaving out. No more being afraid. Amen. Does that make sense? It says, I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. To have, you know, we do this when we want something, you know, we put stuff in the refrigerator, we write our name on it. So no one will come and take it. They know it belongs to you, but that really doesn't help. Understand this. Yeah. This implies ownership. He's saying, I'm going to write my name on you. You belong to me. You belong to me. The new city, I'm going to write that on you as well. You belong here. This is your eternal resting place. You are mine. You are my people. You are my children. And we're going to be together for all of eternity. Does that make sense? Forever and ever. It says, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is for all of us. If you can receive it, receive it. Hear what he's saying. He said it then, he's saying it now. This wasn't just for them. This is for all of us to understand, because we all go through the same things. Understand he's talking to you as well. If you can hear it, receive it, and know that one day we will never be apart from him ever again. We will see that. We're not now, but we'll see that in its entirety. We'll understand that in its entirety then. Never again will we experience pain, suffering, turmoil. We will be with him forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this word and this encouragement, Lord. I just pray that we can just have faith in that. You are God of your word, and so we just stand on that and just trust that you're going to get us through whatever we're going through, all the trials, all the tribulations. And so we just say thank you. We don't deserve it. Couldn't never earn it. It's just who you are. You're a good God. You're a good, loving God. And so we just say thank you. Thank you for this promise. Give us strength to persevere when we feel like giving up, when we feel like we're just hopeless. We don't feel like we have much power, much ability to do much of anything. May we just remain fast, hold what we have, and trust in you. Be faithful with what you've given us, what you've called us to do. We thank you, Father. We praise you. Thank you again for this word. May it not fall upon deaf ears, but may it seep into the very hearts of all those that may hear it. We give you all the glory and all the praise in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.